Hello, everyone. Welcome to Game Worker Solidarity, organizing from the screen to the table. Wonderful to have you here. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Austin Kelmore, and I'll be kicking this off. This event is in two parts today. The first is announcing Game Worker Solidarity. And I have Jamie and Natalia here to talk with me about the project. And then the second part is a discussion with Activision Blizzard and Paizo workers about their experiences organizing and unionizing in the games industry. Jamie, would you like to give a quick introduction for yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm Jamie Woodcock, and I've been working on the Game Worker Solidarity Project with Austin, and I'm an academic based in the UK.
And Natalia, how about yourself?
Sure. My name is Natalia Nedzetskaya. I'm also an academic. I'm a sociologist at the University of California, Berkeley. And I'm a part of Collective Action in Tech, which is an archive of the tech workers movement. We've been working with Game Worker Solidarity for a little while. And I'm really excited to be here for this effort.
Great, thank you. As I mentioned, I'm Austin Kelmore, and I've been an engineer and engineering manager for the past 14 years in the games industry. I'm one of the many game workers in the UK that helped found the game workers branch of the IWGB union, and was its secretary, then chair, and now an active member. A little over a year ago, John from Haymarket Books kindly invited Jamie Woodcock, Emma Kanema, and myself to have a conversation and reflect over the past several years of worker organizing in the games industry. While we were talking before the event, we bounced around ideas for a way to capture all of the knowledge we had in our heads about the many struggles game workers have had to improve their working conditions across the globe. Out of that discussion came the idea for what would become Game Worker Solidarity. And today, I'm so proud of the work that everyone has done over the past year to make it a reality. We've built a site that has a map and a list of every collective movement of game workers that we've been able to find going back almost 70 years in one case. We want to not only show the events involving well-known companies like Activision Blizzard, but also the ones that are less well-known, like a current one with Lockwood Publishing, where the workers are trying to force the company to obey the law. 3.5 years ago, when Game Workers Unite first started, I didn't know anything about unions or organizing at all in either the US where I'm originally from or the UK where I now live. I still remember the first meeting about unionizing I went to and how nervous I was. Since that meeting, I feel like I've learned a ridiculous amount. And what I've seen time and time again is that we are more powerful together than we are alone. This living archive of collective movements by game workers is something I wish I had when I started out to help me see that others are pushing together all over the world. So together, we will make a better games industry and a better world. So that's my kind of little spiel in the beginning. I'd love to hand it off to Jamie.
Thanks so much, Austin. What Austin didn't tell you, of course, is we were playing video games on the call, or rather Austin was playing video games and I was trying to desperately catch up while we were playing together. And, you know, what I really like about this project is it's one of those things where we kind of, you know, a couple of us got together and said, you know, wouldn't this thing be a great idea to do? Wouldn't it have been nice for us to have it when the game worker organizing started? And then, you know, a year later, something pops up out of the internet and can play that role. And yeah, I mean, I think a lot has changed since Austin, Emma, and I had that conversation when we were doing an event with Haymarket. And an awful lot has changed since the first time I met you, Austin, in terms of game worker organizing. And I think for me, one of the reasons why I think this project is important is, you know, often we look back at moments like this and think, you know, amazing things have happened or people have gone through so much or they've learned all these things. But we rarely at the time think, let's document what's going on. You know, let's collect those stories in the here and now. Let's find out where people went from one campaign to another, or, you know, who was introduced to who, and, you know, what union got involved supporting one group of workers, or what we can learn from campaigns in one place or another. And so we kind of said to ourselves, it would be really great to not look back in 5 years' time and go, wouldn't it have been nice to remember the details of the victories that people had in the game workers, in the industry, in the UK and the US and elsewhere. And so this is what we're really trying to do with the project, is to capture those successes that people are having, to share stories about where game workers have been able to organize, where they've been able to win something from an employer, you know, where they've launched a campaign or they've tried some new creative tactic. Because I think what Austin says is really important, that when all of this started, there were very few resources for game workers to look to and say, that's what organizing can look like in our industry. You know, that's what successfully coming together and winning something looks like. And so we were really inspired, and that's why it's really fantastic to have Natalia on the call as well, is inspired by what Collective Action in Tech had been doing with documenting tech worker struggles. Because I think, you know, Haymarket books aside, there are very, very few places that publicize effectively what working class organizing looks like, what industrial organizing looks like, what new forms of trade unionism look like. And so these things can be really hard to find. And that's what we want to do with this project, is to publicize what's been happening, to share things with the hope that it can become a kind of live archive that that people look to for inspiration, and look to for thinking about new steps in campaigns, but also that we can all look back on in the future and kind of see where things have gone and when they're going. And Austin and I also have a competition, which I hope you don't mind me saying on the call, Austin, which is we're trying to find the earliest ever example of game worker organizing. And I thought I had won this competition by looking at a factory occupation of Atari workers in Ireland in the 70s. But Austin's currently in the lead, having found a protest of workers at Nintendo when it was a kind of card game manufacturer. So please have a look at the website. You know, if you see things that are missing, we'd love for people to add examples of things they've done or things we've missed. And you can also enter the competition for the earliest ever example of game worker organizing. But yeah, on a more serious note, there are a few thank yous that I want to say for the project. I mean, of course, thank you to Natalia, who's going to come on and speak next, for the inspiration from Collective Action in Tech. But I also want to say a big thank you to the cooperative that developed the website for us, Common Knowledge, and in particular to Gemma, to Jan and Alex, who've worked really hard on putting together this website that we're really proud to put out into the world. To thank the Open University, because they paid for it. So to thank them for the grant that gave us the time to do this. Thanks to Haymarket, of course, for setting up this talk, but also for the chance for me and Austin and Emma to have that discussion. And then I also just want to say I'm incredibly humbled that we have workers involved in live campaigns at Activision Blizzard and at Paizo who are going to come and share their experiences. And we hope the website can be useful for things that all of you are doing, and for other game workers out there who are looking at what you're doing and thinking, I want to have a go at that. We hope this website can play some role in doing that. So yeah, thanks a lot, everyone.
Thank you, Jamie. And Talia, I'd love to hear kind of your thoughts on your experiences with Collective Action in Tech and how you see game worker solidarity working with that.
Thank you, Austin, and thank you, Jamie. It's so exciting for me to be here because I feel like this archiving itself can be thought of as a movement and can play such an important role in defining movements, even when they're decades and years along in the process. So it's exciting to see this, and it's also exciting to see people thinking about technology as something that's historical, because I think we haven't had that perspective really in the industry, in the press, in other places. I will say you guys have this beat. Our earliest event in the archive is 1969. So good job, 1955. I'm jealous. Yeah, I'll speak a little bit about collective action in tech and what it is, and a bit about how that project came about. And I think, you know, the goals are the same. So this is an archive that was started by tech workers for tech workers. Full credit goes to J.S. Tan and Ben Tarnoff, who some of you might know for his amazing work covering the tech workers movement as a journalist. So this started out on GitHub, and it was just a collection of protests that had happened in tech recently. Maven was making a big splash at Google. The tech lash was something that journalists were getting excited about and covering. And people had this conception in their minds that, wow, this is brand new. We've never seen anything like it. And the archive, when JS and Ben started archiving this, I think it already became apparent to them, there's a longer history here. And when you think about these tech worker movements, worker movements in general, in terms of the history, you realize these issues aren't new and they keep recurring. And there are bigger systemic problems that exist in these industries and kind of exist in our economy. So archiving this, for instance, I'll give an example I like to use. Amazon's earliest organizing efforts were in the early 2000s, like 2004, I want to say. And we're seeing a lot of news headlines with Amazon workers right now. When you realize some of those efforts have been going on for decades, it puts things into perspective and it makes you realize, you know, this is why organizing is important. This is why having that formal kind of structured change is as important as it is. The work that, and I'll mention, we are big fans of your work, Jamie, and we never sought to archive the game workers movement because it seemed like there was already such a rich history, and almost like it was such an inspiring history. It felt like tech workers are catching on late in the game, and your archive proves that in some ways. Our archive never looked at video games specifically. It's fantastic that we now have this incredible resource for workers to draw upon and to kind of inform us of that history. I think these sorts of efforts are so important for reasons that you mentioned, really providing workers resources, letting them know what's going on in the industry, what happened, what worked, what didn't. What kind of reaction you can expect for management. And I also think that historical framing, I mean, we've had a lot of journalists use our archive, and it changes how they write stories, because all of a sudden, they're not writing about an isolated event, they're writing about a movement. And you realize that movements are, you know, thousands of people strong. It's never just a single whistleblower. There are so many people that are behind that. So I think that emphasis on the collective is so, so important. And on solidarity. And this event that's happening here, the fact that we have workers from the industry who are doing the hard work of organizing, I think that's really what this comes down to. It comes down to, are these resources helpful for you all? And are we in communication with you? Because I think these archives need to be defined by the people who are involved in these movements. They don't need to be defined by, you know, academics who are sitting in armchairs and ivory towers somewhere. So having events like this and sharing the narratives and, you know, the realities of what organizing looks like, that's just so, so, so important. I want to leave room for those narratives. So I feel like I've said my bit. I'm happy to answer questions, of course, but really this space is yours. And yeah, I applaud this effort, this project. It's so cool.
Thank you. That was lovely. I would love to just kind of go over the basics of the website for a little bit and show you what we've done. So the kind of impetus for this all was being able to show that the organizing around the world is really happening in, like, around the world. Oftentimes we hear of things in Ubisoft or Activision Blizzard in like very specific locations, but we can perhaps miss things that happen in like South Korea or Japan or, you know, things that happened 30, 40 years ago, something like that. So what we've done is built a website that you can see both the map and the timeline, as well as all of the events that have happened. And this is something that we've painstakingly collected, but as Jamie said earlier, I'm sure we've also missed a bunch. So if you want to add stuff, I see that actually during this call, we've already had someone submit something, which is fantastic. So please, please submit more. And one of the things I think that was really interesting is just as we were going through this, we were constantly finding more and more things and being able to tie storylines together and understand kind of the history of organizing in the games industry. You know, a very specific instance that Jamie talks about is the occupation of a factory in Limerick, an Atari factory. And similar time, at the similar time in California, they were going for a union vote, which they ended up not winning, but it's still all related to kind of the struggle that was going on at the workplace. And so being able to see all of that and dive into all of it is just kind of opened my eyes in a way to kind of all the organizing that's going on. So we hope that, like Natalia said, you know, news organizations will be able to use this site. Other organizers will be able to use it. We'll be able to provide analysis or kind of insights that we have as game worker organizers ourselves to help others kind of foster and grow this movement. So one of the things also is that all of this data is completely accessible on the website. If you go to the data tab, you can see all of the Airtable data, which is, you can download it as a CSV, you can use it however you want. I would love to see what others can do with this data, what you can analyze, what you can figure out. So please, please go for it. And I think, that's kind of the gist. Jamie, did you want to follow up with anything there?
I think that's a really great, really, really great overview to it. And I guess just to say, you know, there are probably many things that we've missed, and there may well be things that people know more about an event that happened. And we've tried to make it really easy to see the data, but also to submit your own entry. And if there's stuff on there that you think should be there, you know, please get in touch with us. Let us know about it. And I guess, you know, one of the things that I'm kind of keen for us to think about is, you know, unlike in the 70s when the Atari workers were occupying, or unlike the Nintendo example in the 50s, you know, we have other ways to document struggles and share them today, right? And I think there are some really fantastic examples, like the Kickstarter podcast that really goes through the history of organizing there, of, you know, we should be using the tools that are available to us to share what we're doing and share lessons with other people. Because that's what I think what's been so exciting about what's happening in the games industry, right? Is the speed and creativity of things that have been happening. And I think there's lots of people that could take inspiration from that. But I don't want to take any more of the time, because I think we've got some fantastic speakers to come.
Great. Maybe we can open it up to a little bit of Q&A if there are any questions about the website initially. And then we can move on to talking with the Activision Blizzard workers and Paizo workers. All right. So there's no questions about the site yet. So I guess what we can do then is let's move over to the Activision Blizzard workers and Paizo workers. And then if people want to ask questions about the website, have a look themselves, feel free to ask questions in the chat, and we will get to them at the end then. All right, so I will hand this over to Alex then.
Oh gosh, that's me. Okay. I actually, before you hand things over to me, I do actually have a question about the website. I was going to break in, but I didn't know if it was my place to do so. You've said a little bit, you know, that you'd like people to contribute events and solidarity things that they find. Can you talk me as a layman through how I might do that if I find this article about something that's happened?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So there is a submit action button submit action tab at the top there, which connects to a form that you can fill out that literally has the date, you can specify the country, the location, the name of the event, a short summary, and a link to some article that describes the event. And if there's any relevant information, like a flyer or something that you want to attach just to archive, then feel free to attach that. And then some notes as well. And basically, if you submit that, then we get a notification about it and just have to look at it, probably do some little formatting, and then approve it. So it's a very, very quick process from you submitting something to us being able to approve it and it going live on the site. Yeah, good question. Thank you.
Awesome. Yeah, that's super useful. I like that it's, you know, it's very much a living contribute to. And another very important question, what is the prize for finding the oldest worker action?
I don't know that we've ever considered one. Maybe pride?
It's to be confirmed, yeah.
Ah, great. It's bragging rights right now. That's a good enough prize for some. Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you both, and thank you, Natalia, as well for for inviting us to this event, because we're all here because of the website and to promote it and to talk about what it means and gamer solidarity and all those sorts of things. So I'll just introduce myself real quick, and then I will ask the other workers that are here with me from the game industry to go ahead and introduce themselves. But my name is Alex Spidel, he, him. I work for Paizo. I have worked for Paizo Publishing for almost the last 2 years at this point. I am the organized play coordinator, which means that I work with our volunteers in our community to put on our events and our games in the local game stores. Yeah, I was also one of the organizers for the Paizo unionization movement that took place over the past couple of months and that is still in progress as we start to work on negotiating our contract. But it's very exciting to be, you know, sort of part of this movement, part of this industry. And so I want to talk to some of the other workers that are here with me, one of whom I work with regularly and the others I'm getting to meet today. Let's see. I'm just going to pull up the participant list here and start down the list that way for introductions. Aubrey, would you like to introduce yourself?
I was dreading this moment.
You're up first.
My name is Aubrey Ryan. I am one of our organizers at Activision Blizzard. I do a lot of more, well, Jess faces a lot of our official social media and stuff of that nature. I tend to push our internal initiatives and have been doing a lot to help represent our workers and uplift them in the workplace.
Awesome. Thank you for being here. Let's see. Jessica?
Hey, I'm Jessica Gonzalez. I work at Blizzard Entertainment currently. I've been in the video game industry for about 7 years now. And I have organized two of our walkouts, and I inspired another studio to have a walkout that they're having currently. So that is developing and ongoing. And yes, like Aubrey mentioned, I've done a lot of the press releases and official messaging from our ABK Workers Alliance to you know, the community and the press. So I do a lot of that work there, but I really do appreciate Aubrey and Nora so much because they help with a lot of the internal initiatives.
Yeah. Speaking of Nora, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. So my name's Nora. I'm a senior software engineer at Blizzard. I helped with some of the physical walkout logistics early on, and today, the role I take is concerned citizen. I mainly listen. I have a lot of one-on-one conversations with coworkers across the company about workplace issues, and I try to learn ways that we can make things better at the company.
Awesome. Thank the three of you for being here from Activision Blizzard. And then my coworker, Jenny, if you would like to introduce yourself as well.
Yeah, hi. I'm Jenny Jarzabski, she, they. I work at Paizo as a developer. I've been writing and creating game design, different content for the tabletop RPG industry for about 8 years now. Like Alex, I am one of the organizing members of the United Paizo Workers Union, which we did in the past months get recognized by our workplace, which is excellent. But of course, our work isn't over as we are preparing to move into negotiations with our leadership team and the executives at Paizo. And again, I'm just really thankful to be here with you folks from Blizzard and Blizzard Activision, rather, and other folks in the gaming industry who've been doing so much awesome work. It's really cool. And this is just a super awesome movement. And it's interesting how connected we all can be now with things like social media and the internet. So it's really cool to be here.
Yeah. Jenny, I want to aid you slightly by pointing out that I've just done the math and the recognition was actually 2 whole months ago, which is both longer than I thought and not nearly long enough.
Yeah. I almost said weeks, and then I thought to myself, wait a minute, I think it's been more like months. What is time? Yeah, I don't know. But yeah.
Yeah, time time is a lot lately. Anyway.
Yes.
Yeah, so I wanna sort of talk to each group about kind of how organizing kind of started at the workplace and sort of what things look like now and kind of what inspired that, and really get a top line view for those who might not be familiar with one or both of our companies. But before we do that, because we are here, you know, celebrating the launch of the Solidarity website, you know, for anyone who wants to speak up, I just want to know kind of what something that you like about the website or something that you think is going to be, you know, useful to us, not just in our own organizing efforts or just the game industry in general as we unionize going forward, because I think it's a really great tool and I'd like to kind of highlight some of the ways that we think it's going to help us out. So if anyone wants to go ahead and jump in with that. Don't all speak up at once. I mean, I can answer, but then I'll just be monologuing. So.
I'll answer. I think it's great to have an archive of everything that's been done and currently being done because we can learn from each other, right? Like, we're less siloed. I feel like as an industry, we kind of get siloed in our disciplines. So, like, it's nice to have the grand picture of, like, here's everything that went well. Here's where we failed in some way. So it's, like, a group learning experience as well as, like, a live archive of everything going on and has gone on for a while. So I'm really, really liking this and happy to be a part of it. So thank you for having me.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think another thing is, like Jessica said, history is very important. Every day, you know, we try to be a better version of who we were yesterday. My hope is that by documenting this history, one day people will look back and get to feel good about how far we've come.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, I think it's nice for me to kind of see the different things that have gone on and just sort of be part of that history and just adding another step to it. It's very strange still for me even to, like, have my name in the credits of books or something. So to know that things that we're doing are going to be documented on this is just, it's a lot, but it's exciting, I think. So yeah, I think where I would like to start here, and I'll start with the Activision Blizzard folks, is just, can you kind of, you know, we're talking about history here. Can you kind of give me a sense of the organization that has occurred at your company, like sort of what started you all to start talking to each other, start really planning these kinds of actions, and how has that sort of, you know, galvanized or grown over the past months to where we are now?
Yeah, it's a great question, and I'll take this one if anyone minds. Sure. Cool. Okay, so I will say it was kind of like a mass agitation event. I think everyone kind of can get a sense of what that was. But it was almost as if, like, wow, we're living through someone else's, like, history, and people that are currently at the company, you know, like, not feeling safe, right? So I think we all just kind of collectively agreed that this was something that we need to do better on, and our leadership, you know, was mishandling a lot of it. So we kind of just started having discussions and then opening those discussions even broader. And it's just been a lot of work from agitation to action. So it's actually quite nice to see. And yeah, I feel like we still have some work to do. And I'm really excited to have Paizo here because, you know, they did it. So it's really cool. and yeah, I think it was just that mass agitation event that everyone was like, all right, solidarity time.
Yeah, whoops, I clicked the wrong button. For Nora and Aubrey, what was that time sort of like for you? There was this mass agitation event, which, you know, we can make allusions to, but I guess sort of what were you feeling and what sort of made you want to get involved as part of that?
So I think the mass agitation event, I mean, so back in July, the California Department of Fair Employment and Housing filed a lawsuit against Activision Blizzard for fostering a company culture in which female employees were subjected to sexual harassment, discrimination, and unequal pay. The allegations outlined in the lawsuit were pretty harrowing. So everyone was kind of reeling from that news because not everybody was aware that this was going down. And then the company then released a statement which claimed that the lawsuit contained distorted and in many cases false descriptions of Blizzard's past. And so, you know, for me, I got to look around and witness a lot of the folks who were there during that time and had actually been victims of some of this behavior and some of these things outlined in the lawsuit started stepping forward. And basically, they felt as though the company was calling them liars. It was actually quite emotional. I got to see, you know, the raw anxiety, sadness, frustration, anger of a lot of my colleagues. So it was heartbreaking. So for me, it was just a matter of I was thinking, like, how can I, you know, let people know what they can do within, you know, the confines of like California law, for instance. I don't have much, but I do have, like, you know, if I feel like I'm doing something, then I feel like I'm somehow, you know, pushing forward and being there for them.
So for me, probably the most incredible thing that I've watched out of all of this is the people that were neutral to everything since the initial lawsuit breakage suddenly becoming very involved in our activism. We had the Wall Street Journal article break and a lot of the details of what our leadership was aware of. And it was just a call to arms. We saw thousands more of our peers pool into our spaces, looking for ways that they can be involved, looking for ways that they can help. And I think that was really inspiring to watch. And it really pushed me to be more active and take a bigger stand and help guide in directions, ways people could go and where we could be involved.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting to, you know, hear those stories and kind of see, oh yeah, we kind of went through a lot of the same stuff. So I guess on that, I will sort of, you know, pivot over to Jenny and ask sort of, you know, can you say a lot of the same things and sort of talk about how the efforts at Paizo started and what sort of inspired that group to start organizing as well?
Yeah, there are a lot of similarities in these two tales. Ours on a smaller scale, but I'm hearing just a lot of the same landmarks that happened in our journey too. We also had sort of an inciting incident and some publicity surrounding incidents of allegations made by former employees. And we had, you know, all these stories kind of coming out, and our community was, you know, our community of like players and fans and volunteers, as well as our staff, were absolutely, you know, outraged and shocked in some cases by this information. And so everyone, there was that same kind of outpouring of support, not only between the staff, but also our contractors, our freelance writers and developers, designers mostly. They kind of came together, and the first thing they actually did after they sort of formed this little network completely independently of the staff. We actually didn't know this had happened until much later, but they formed a little network and they started planning what they wanted to do and how they wanted to respond, because this was a group of people who they make the material and the books that we publish possible by contributing a lot of their writing and their expertise to it. So they decided that they didn't want to work with our company until certain allegations had been addressed and until leadership was making a commitment to work with us, the staff, to make a better workplace environment for us. And so they sent out a letter to some of our executives saying they would no longer work and in some cases would withhold their work until that time, you know, until such a time as, you know, those things had been addressed. And that was extremely powerful because, you know, they didn't know if they would be, that was essentially a non-official strike or demonstration because they didn't have any employment guarantees or any protections as contractors. And we saw it on staff as a massive, or most of us saw it as just kind of this massive support gesture. And in a way, they really made this possible. At that point, we all started talking to them and talking to each other just to emotionally support each other, hearing these allegations, looking around, seeing, like, looking at our own experiences, comparing, say, you know, seeing what could be better, seeing stories break in the media of, like, what was going on at Activision and other gaming companies. And we all were able to come together using Discord and Skype and texting and just kind of realize that we had a support group and that there were people who wanted a union. Like the more people we all messaged, like, hey, should we organize? Like, is that something we want? And then realizing it's something everyone or most people really had thought about at least once. And so that kind of gave birth to our movement and got overwhelming support within our staff. So yeah, it really was that show of community and us really being in solidarity with each other that led us to be able to do that and start having those conversations.
Yeah, it was an emotional time, I think, for a lot of us, but it was inspiring to sort of see everyone come together. And like you say, we took, you know, a lot of inspiration from the folks over at Activision and Blizzard who were similarly, you know, starting to organize and speak up mm-hmm. around the same time. And I want to ask them, you know, sort of briefly, what sort of led you to specifically decide that you were going to organize a walkout and that's what you wanted to do. So sort of how did that, I guess, come together as far as how did you decide to do? And then sort of mechanically, how did you, you know, say, okay, this is what we're doing. This is when we're doing it. And this is why we're doing it.
Yeah, I can talk to that. So we, like Jenny mentioned, you know, Discord is like a huge thing. So we kind of just like got everyone into Discord server and we're like, hey, like who wants to organize a walkout? And I was like, I do. And then so we just were like, here's all the things we need. We need signs and just kind of like went through all the logistics. We had like people that were like, okay, I'm going to bring waters for everyone. We had people donate porta potties, which was really crazy. Oh, and wow. Awesome. Yeah, we had like it was such a great solidarity time. Just like, no, we're not going to accept this as workers. Like we could do better. So we all just collectively organized through Discord and yeah, we had a pretty successful walkout and open letter and, you know, trying to just make sure that we show our leadership that we want to hold them accountable because, you know, it was just like unacceptable, the things that were going on. And I think all of us were just collectively horrified, shocked. And, you know, we put that into something good and something where we can show survivors that they're not alone.
I love the detail of someone donating porta potties because that's never a thing I would have thought of, but like, yeah, you might need that if you're standing outside all day, you know?
Yeah, there was a row. And then there was another game company donated a food truck. So they were coming in, passing out food to people, which was wonderful. It was really a nice event. And people were riding on blue hearts. And our archivist at Blizzard saved all of them. So that was really sweet. So
That's awesome. Yeah. There was a question that sparked in my brain and I don't remember what it was. So I guess it wasn't that important, but I mean, yeah, it's really exciting to hear about. I've gotten myself totally thrown off. So I think, you know, oh, I remember what it was. It's great. You know, we're talking about these ways in which, you know, we're supporting each other within our companies and showing solidarity that way. But, you know, there's also these stories of showing solidarity sort of, you know, between game companies and not even game companies, but other companies. I know that the folks over at Image Comics who are unionizing have contacted those of us at Paizo Workers and said, hey, like, part of the reason we're doing this is because we saw you do it. And we were like, hey, we could do that too. So, you know, I guess just, you know, what sort of solidarity, like, have you all been able to show, not just within yourselves, but like to other companies as well? I know you talked about, just that you had organized a walkout with another company. So if you want to touch on that, but like also, you know, what sort of support have you gotten from other game companies that you can talk about publicly, obviously, or just other unions in general?
Yeah, sure. Actually, a lot of people reached out to me when, you know, we were doing our organizing. Ubisoft was one, and they also have a better Ubisoft over on Twitter, and they're organizing their workplace as well, I believe. And right now, currently, it's actually through ABK, but Raven Studio just was hit by layoffs. A lot of the contract employees were... a third of the workforce was laid off. So right now, all of our QA department across ABK is walking out until their demands are met, because it was an issue where they were told to relocate from Texas to Wisconsin and then promised that they were going to get full-time positions and then laid off at the end of the quarter. So this is something that, you know, we obviously won't let happen in our company, and you know, an injury to one is an injury to all. So we're kind of just showing that solidarity with all of them today and continuously. This is our first multi-day kind of initiative, and you know, kind of going from there. But yeah, it's been great to communicate with the wider groups and kind of see what went well and what didn't go for them. So yeah, just continuing to have those discussions is great.
Yeah, and I think that's sort of another thing that the website will be able to do is sort of show us, like, okay, you know, we have these walkouts and protests of the QA. Once those are completed or resolved one way or the other, people will be able to see, you know, how they were resolved or how companies fought back. So it's, you know, really important to share that information. And yeah, you know, on that topic as well, you know, at Paizo, a lot of our books rely on freelance writers, freelance designers, things like that, because our company is so small that we don't have a lot of those. We don't have a lot of the resources that we would need in-house to have people on staff to write them. So we rely a lot on freelancers. And I know that there was a question that came in asking about the increasing use of freelancers and how that sort of impacts the approach to organizing, you know, contract workers as well sort of fall under that. So I would love to hear, you know, Jenny, talk about how that's impacting our organizing, but also for those of you, you know, at Activision Blizzard, if you can talk to how you, I don't know exactly what your freelancer or contract structure looks like there, but how that affects sort of the organizing as well.
So I think at Paizo and companies like that, like smaller companies, we do have an edge in that regard, because we as developers and designers are oftentimes contacting and actually helping. Like we don't actually send the contract and handle the legal side, but we are selecting and working with the freelancers and contractors that work on the products we're leading. So that is a little bit easier, because you're able to make a more of a personal, you know, business relationship with that person. You actually get to speak with them and can, you know, have their contact information, even if it's just business. Of course, for us, we have conventions. You know, there's different conventions of different sizes where we've met a lot of these folks and become friends with some of them, or at least very, you know, friendly workplace acquaintances with them. So it's a lot easier. So in our case, it's easier to organize our colleagues. So I don't know how that is on your side of, you know, of the fence, but I do feel like if at all possible for anyone who is looking to organize at their workplace, try to, you know, so them standing strong with us made that impossible from the get-go. Like our company could not even attempt to do that. They saw that solidarity, and they also, their cooperation just kind of helped us, like helped buoy our spirits and helped us keep going when we were very stressed. So I think for us, the use of freelancers was positive. But again, we're talking about a smaller network of people with whom we've been able to form connections. But I do think that's what it's all about, is trying to remember, especially as work becomes more global and more people are working remote, that we are all people and there is a person at the other side of the screen. So trying to reach out and form a connection with them is something that will help us all with organizing.
Yeah. Is there anything, like I said, I don't know what the sort of structure there looks like at Activision Blizzard. Is there anything that you all can speak to as far as how the freelancers sort of what role they play and how they can help support, how it helps, you know, affect your organizing over there?
Hey, sorry, I was trying to find the unmute button. Is this for like our contractors that are contracted through ABK?
Yeah, so, anyone who's not a permanent worker isn't protected by some of the same labor laws that those of us who are full-time workers are.
Yeah, so I actually got my start in the gaming industry as a contractor at Activision, and then over to Treyarch, and then Blizzard as a contractor, and then went full-time, and then came back to Blizzard. But yeah, so the treatment of contractors in game development, I feel, is just so... It's the legal limit that they're allowed to treat them. Like, they treat them almost as if second-class citizens, and it really depends on if you have a great manager or not. And even if you do have a great manager, it really goes by headcount at the end of the day. But a lot of contractors, I feel, are strung along to where, like, you know, work really hard and we'll extend your contract. And, you know, like our Raven people that just got moved out to Wisconsin and now laid off, it's just like their whole livelihoods, like they were promised that they were going to get, you know, compensation and conversion and all that. And it just seems really unfair. And, you know, I want to shine a light on that practice, especially under game development, because I think we could do so much better for our contractors. And they work on freaking amazing games that we all love. So they should be able to get a free version of the product at least, or, you know, something like that. But just super solidarity with them. I was growing up like in the industry through that. So I definitely don't want it to happen to anyone else.
Yeah.
Speaking as a current Blizzard contractor and from someone that's involved in organizing, it's very difficult because people don't have set contract ends. The people that might have been integral to your union organizing or any kind of effort can suddenly just be gone. Their contract is over and they're not there to help you anymore. And that's something that isn't really talked about, that at will.
Yeah, I know that the at-will nature of employment in a lot of places is one of the things that I know at Paizo we're glad to be done away with now that we are under a union, that we can't be, you know, terminated at will, that there has to be a process that they follow. So more people should have those protections. I don't know, just a thought. let's see, we had another couple other questions come in from chat, so I'm gonna scroll back up and grab a couple of them. So, you know, as we're talking about these kind of labor actions that we're taking, these walkouts, these protests that we're doing, it's something that I definitely see a lot, you know, especially like with the recent Kellogg's strike that's happening, is a lot of people are saying, okay, you know, now we have to boycott these companies because they're not treating their workers right. You know, there's some that definitely think that, and there's others that say, no, don't do that. That hurts the workers. So I'm curious as to sort of this group's thought, if boycotting a product is the most effective way to support workers, if there are other things to do. I'm curious as to anyone's thoughts here.
I can go again. I feel like I've been talking a lot. so I'm trying not to take over the whole. But yeah, I have mixed feelings on this. While I believe that, like, the people that create the products, you know, that's their work and we should be celebrating their work. And it's just unfortunate. I feel like it's almost a lose-lose either way, I want to say. Like, you know, if you boycott the product, then the product loses capital, then the most vulnerable workers are cut. And then if you boycott and, like, you know, hurt them in their wallet and there's, like, enough visibility there, it might do some good. So really, I don't like to tell people what to do. I think I just tell them to do what you feel is right. I know, like, I've made personal choices to boycott products. I've made personal choices not to do that. It's just something that you have to reflect on with your own values and kind of ask yourself, like, does this hurt the workers? Is this, you know, in their best interest? And go from there.
Yeah, I know that sort of a big thing for us at Paizo, when these allegations were all coming out, there were a lot of people talking about canceling orders and things like that. And Jenny, I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, but I remember, you know, what I kept telling people was, we're not calling for a boycott right now. So, you know, do what's in your heart. If you feel you can't support us, then do that. But, you know, I think also it's sort of different, you know, for a small company like Paizo. You know, I don't know, 50 people canceling orders might do a lot of harm. I have no look at our sales numbers, but, like, you know, I'm pulling a number. Whereas for, you know, a huge AAA company like Blizzard, you know, 50, 100 people canceling orders is not that big a deal. So I think it's also sort of different depending on the company.
Yeah, and I agree with what y'all are saying. Basically, I think you do just, as a, you know, as a person, you have to do what you think is right, because it's a really weird position to be in, where you're saying, hey, my friends and I and my coworkers worked on this awesome product and it's so good. Like, this game is so good and I'm so proud of it. But also our company is doing some really sketchy things and we're like organizing right now. And maybe, you know, we don't want to support them continuing these policies. So it's hard to say which has the most impact. And I agree with you, Jessica, that it's just, it feels like a lose-lose sometimes, sadly.
Yeah, and I will say, like, if you want to help community-wise, we have a Better ABK account on Twitter where we are very vocal and working on organizing and kind of like getting that bridge connection between the players and the organizers. So yeah, feel free to check us out on Twitter. Just a quick plug.
No, yeah. Jenny, do you remember our Twitter handle offhand?
Yes, I want to say, I can check it real quick. I want to say it's just at Paizo Workers.
I'm like, yes, 90% sure that's what it is, yes.
Yeah, at Paizo Workers, so P-A-I-Z-O Workers on Twitter. We also have a website, paizoworkers.org, or unitedpaizoworkers.org. Yes. And that's another great way to support us, especially if you are boycotting products from companies that you're, you know, you're questioning the morality or ethics of their decision making towards their staff. You can definitely support workers directly there. I know that we have some merchandise we've made up that's going towards kind of operating costs for the union and potentially a mutual aid fund. I'm sure there are many others of those sorts of funds that exist. And just leaving comments, like positive comments, and reaching out and reading, you know, if there's an action we're asking customers to take, like, hey, if you could sign this petition, you know I saw several for Blizzard recently and signed them, or hey, if you could send an email to this person in our executive team and let them know, you know, you're not okay with this, or support this initiative. Those things could have an impact.
Yeah, I think for me the most important thing is just to kind of take a cue from the workers, and if they're saying, yeah, you know, don't go out and buy this product, then, you know, don't do that. But otherwise, you know, decide what's in your heart. I'm certainly never going to judge anyone who says, oh, I don't want to support the executives because they're doing this. Sorry, I was reminded of a question earlier. Thank you, Thank you, Aubrey. But, you know, another question that has come in from chat, and something that I know that we get a lot, and I'm sure that other people get when labor they say, there's a lot of comments on the forums. Well, if things are so bad, why don't you just quit? You know, if it's that bad. So, you know, how do you all sort of respond to that argument, Aubrey, if you want to start, that we should, you know, be happy to be able to do something that we love, that we should be so grateful to, you know, work for these companies and get to publish books? You know, how do you sort of respond to those kind of arguments?
So while we are very passionate about what we do, that shouldn't be a blanket for discrimination, exploitation, and abuse. We should be able to have a living wage and a thriving wage in an industry that is the fastest growing that the industrial world has ever seen. We have the ability to do and be better, and we shouldn't let that we love what we do allow mistreatment. And it's very important that we are always advocating for one another and always standing up for one another to make our industry better.
Oh, sorry, I thought someone else was jumping in there. Yeah, I think it's important to remember that, you know, people should be able to put food on the table and pay bills, not to get radical, but
in this society. but I hope that one day, whoever it is that comes in and takes a position, like when I retire, when I move on, that they have a better life too, and they're not under this constant stress and have this horrible environment where they don't feel safe and don't feel respected by their peers in their industry.
Yeah, and one thing you said as part of the question was, like, the argument is that, like, we should be happy to be able to do something we love, and I agree, but the company we work for should be happy to be able to employ such competent and passionate people, and the people who work on these games, you know, they're my heroes, but they're also people, and people shouldn't be treated like expendable commodities.
Agree. Wholeheartedly there. Yeah, we should be nurturing passion, not exploiting passion.
Yeah, absolutely. ABK's spirit and heart has always been its people.
Yeah, and I think the past couple of months have shown those of us who work at Paizo who maybe weren't sure about it, that our community and is the heart of what we do, and our people are wonderful, and if you, you know, grind them into dust and spit them out, then it doesn't create a great culture. And, you know, on that, a question that someone else asked, especially for those of you over at Blizzard, you know, why do you think it is that the QA people and the CS people, the customer service people and the quality assurance people, for those of us who are not up on the industry lingo, why is it that they sort of get a lot of the brunt of the abuse and the crunch culture in work? Do you think is that a culture where it's just they're the ones on the bottom of the pyramid, so they get crushed by all the weight on top? Is it people who are just sort of willing to toil in those jobs? What do you think it is that sort of leads them to sort of suffer a lot of the brunt of it?
Yeah, I'll take this one. So for me, I'll say, like, I got into the gaming industry through quality assurance. It is seen as, I don't agree with it, but it's seen as entry level, as well as our customer service avenues. And a lot of people actually use those avenues to go into other disciplines. However, personally, I see myself, like, as a quality assurance professional, and I believe that there is a career path there. I just feel that gaming in general is very behind in that regard, as well as, like, career advancement. They definitely sell it as, you know, come work for a game company, and then they don't tell you it's a contract position, or, like, they kind of rely on people not knowing their rights or not knowing, you know, how to get into the industry otherwise. So it's used to kind of keep people at this, like, low bar. They're considered, like, the low, you know, people in the company, which I, like, myself, Nora, and Aubrey are doing a lot of work to kind of destigmatize that, because we don't like the class separation that exists within that culture. And That's definitely something that's older and needs to be broken, like calling QA devs, QAR devs, you know. So that those are conversations that we started having early and continue to enforce. But yeah, also, I think, Nora, did you want to speak on that a little bit?
I was just going to agree. The visuals around QA and CS and the tendency to see those roles as stepping stones just makes it easier for them to take that kind of abuse.
Yeah, I know. I know at Paizo, I have to work somewhat closely with a lot of our customer service people just because of the nature of my sort of job on the operations side of the company. And they are some of the most hardworking people I have ever interacted with, but especially, you know, at the company. And, you know, to see them get treated as expendable because, well, you know, it's just customer service. Anybody can do customer service. They're some of the most beloved people in our community. And so, you know, we have to, every worker should be treated as incredibly valuable, but especially those who are public facing and who are doing a lot of that grunt work, you know, they need to be compensated fairly, just like everyone else.
Yeah. And I wanted to add there, like specifically for customer service, they are absolute champions because anytime any scandal or anything comes in the news, they are the first to hear about it because, you know, people don't really know how to vent their frustrations. So they'll kind of vent their grievances with the company through customer service. And unfortunately, not only are they being abused by their employer, but as well as, you know, disgruntled players. So that's unfortunate as well. So we definitely, a lot of the solidarity there was just having conversations with CS, like, how are you feeling? How are the tickets, you know, and just going from there.
This is your semi-regular reminder to all the watchers out there that customer service and retail workers are people too. Thank you very much. And so to follow up on that, actually, because this question has just been sent to me, what do you think some practical things are that we in the industry can do, and even outside of the industry, that we can do to sort of help break down that hierarchy where the QA, the CS, these people who are seen as at the bottom of the pyramid are treated that way? What can we kind of do to break down that hierarchy?
I love that question. So just having conversations with the disciplines, like Blizzard had this program called CS for a day and QA for a day. So like, it didn't matter what discipline you were in, you could go do their job for a day. And then you just learn the respect that like you have for these disciplines. Wow, these people are champions. They love what they do. And yeah, it's just a great thing to see. So I would say have conversations, like just have conversations with people in discipline. What's hard about it? What's great about it? Why, what makes you happy to like come sit down and work for like what you do, you know, just kind of shining a light and destigmatizing the separation and the silo of the departments. Like definitely go by, like call engineer an engineer. Don't just call them a developer, like, and then say developers and QA. You'll say all of them are developers. So then you can just call out engineering, QA, design, you know, that way you're being inclusive in your language with development, because we are all developers. If the product can't ship without your work, you're a developer. So.
Yeah, I think that's good. I think, you know, it's important to treat everyone as the valuable individual they are, and sort of use, like you say, the right terms for them. Call them developers, you know, call the customer service representatives that, don't, you know, just refer to them derogatorily. A question that sort of specifically came in for ADK, but fun fact, this also applies to Paizo. You know, for companies that have workers abroad, you know, ABK has locations abroad, Paizo has a couple of permanent full-time workers up in Canada, you know, how can we, you know, those of us who are organizing both at these companies and others, make sure that we're including the workers that are at those organizations and ending those collective actions? How do we make sure that those people are included? Can they be included? Jenny, I don't know if you want to speak to our friends up in the north.
Sure, I can talk about our Paizo North, as we're sometimes calling it, even though there's only a few of them as yet. So they have been, we've been keeping them in the loop about everything that, you know, everything in regards to the organization. And unfortunately, they, you know, because they're actually, they're contracted through another company. That's just how international, like at least with Canada, I don't know the particulars, but unfortunately they can't be part of our union through CWA. But in talking with our CWA reps, we found out that they could actually qualify. They could have their own organization. Since there's a small number of them, you know, I don't know how that would work for them. I know for us, our union is small enough that we're part of a larger local, like a conglomerate within our region. But that is, we've definitely passed that information along to them and let them know that just as they've, you know, vocally supported us on social media and kind of listened to us vent and vented their own frustrations and praised each other for the work they're doing, that we would be there for them. So again, I think it's just as simple as having a one-to-one talk, sending a message, talking to someone, asking if they need help, getting any resources and saying, hey, I'm here for you. You know, I'm here to help you get those links, or, you know, I have a contact I can put you in touch with. This is our union rep or the organizer we've been talking to. So that's kind of the answer we have so far. Again, I'm sure it's different at a larger company with more out of the country contractors.
Yeah, I'll speak to that a little bit. So it is kind of interesting when you have such a big company like ABK, because we span so far, right? And then having such a, like, we're all in one, like, Slack space, so we can all communicate with each other. So it's kind of interesting to see a lot of the grievances that we share in the U.S. and people in other countries are like, wow, like, how does this even happen? So a lot of it is just having, like, the one-on-one conversations, like Jenny mentioned, super important to know, like, what are the grievances in your location? What can we help you with? You know, just having those conversations and making sure everyone is aligned on a common goal. And that's solidarity, having everyone heard in the company and, you know, making sure that we're just connected and making, like, sharing that information with each other is really important too. Cause you don't know what you're missing if you don't, like, have the thing that you're missing. So if someone from another country has a certain, you know, benefit, then they can share with us, then that's really helpful and will help us push for that as well.
Yeah. And Jenny touched on something. She mentioned something that I also wanted to reiterate for the ABK side of things. I think it's really important to get people in touch with resources, particularly legal resources relevant to their region, so that they can take action while also feeling prepared.
Yeah, one of the things that I've really enjoyed being able to do now that we are not spending quite as much energy on hello, please recognize our union, is sort of using our public platforms to be able to educate people on some of these union things that we're not really taught. And I think the Game Solidarity website, this is a plug, is a great resource for that, because there's a lot of these things that we're just not taught about in schools. You know, we don't learn about unions, about what they can do for us. And, you know, sort of on that, I wanted to kind of take a step back before we get too much further into this and just talk a movement for labor organizing in general, sort of in this country, maybe even worldwide to some degree. And I just wanted to see, kind of get your thoughts on sort of why it is that these things are kind of happening and popping up now generally, but also sort of specifically in the gaming industry. Like, what is it about now that is sort of leading people to say, huh, maybe we should be organizing, maybe we should be unionizing actually? What, you know, what is it that's kind of leading that?
I was trying to unmute. Yeah. I think that it was about time for kind of a second labor movement in the United States. I think there's a lot of factors that are making this all kind of converge at the same time, even faster than it would have even 10, 15 years in the past. Obviously, we have the internet, so we have these tools like Discord that all of us have used to such good effect here. We have Twitter, we have Facebook, other social media sites. And for better or worse, we're all, a lot of us, unless we actively choose not to, are connected. So we're seeing these ideas and we're seeing the news stories both from, you know, news sites as well as people just like reporting, you know, their living, you know, their lives, the news as it happens in their eyes. So it's easier to see what others are doing and get inspired by it, get angry about something and decide we're going to take action. But I know for us, the pandemic was big because, you know, with so many people working from home still, I can't imagine having some of these conversations in our office. Our office is really small and we have this, I've actually never worked a day in that office, but it's like a little cubicle area for most of us. And I can't imagine, you know, turning to someone I'm sitting next to when I know that, you know, the executives are in an office with their door open, not like 20 feet away, and could overhear me saying, hey, this, like, have we ever thought about unionizing? So I really think that's helped. The pandemic has been like, and the last couple of years have just been very stressful for us all. But at the same time, a lot of us have had to step back and take stock of things. And I think people in general are realizing that their lives could be better. And if you're kind of forced into like a small space where you live and work and you're not able to go many places outside of that, you really start to prioritize and think about what are these things and people that I have in my life, and like, can my life be more, and do I want to go back to a normal that maybe isn't good for most people? So I think that's part of it about why this is all kind of happening and picking up steam.
Yeah, definitely agree with you there, Jenny, especially for us, like in quality assurance, we had been asking for a little bit if we could work from home just because the price of living in Irvine is pretty expensive and you need like several roommates if you're in quality assurance or customer service. So we were told for years, like, it wasn't going to happen. It's impossible. Mm. And like, we're doing it now. So that was also a big pushing for, like, we should be pushing for more.
Yeah, hey, same here. Same situation with us in Seattle area, so.
Yes. Seattle ain't cheap.
No.
Yeah, and to sort of follow up on that as well, there was a question that came in a little while ago, but, you know, gaming has also sort of been very much, you know, a flashpoint in the culture wars in a lot of ways. You know, back in the 80s, tabletop role-playing games, you know, meant that you were in a satanic cult and you were trying to summon demons in your mom's basement. You know, there's the whole saga of Gamergate, which we do not have time to get into here, but that was obviously a whole thing. And so, you know, how important is it? Does that have any bearing on the organization, just the way that games sort of have become that touchstone? How do we sort of want to respond to that?
My grandma still kind of thinks that, like, you know, D&D Pathfinder is maybe not evil, but she thinks it's really weird. So there's still a lot of that cultural, like, especially with older folks, there's still that stigma. I think that we are always going to be part of a flashpoint in like culture wars or just changing attitudes, because games are a distillation of, you know, of our human, or really our cultural values and questions that are coming up in our society. It's our dreams. It's what we're imagining. It's what we're afraid of. It's, you know, it's scenarios that we're exploring and interested in playing with. So I think that's always going to be the case, whether it's, you know, the satanic panic or, you know, anything else of, like, you know, more progressive values, fight, you know, kind of stepping in and being opposed to kind of a more conservative cultural standpoint that wants things to stay the same, or yearns for a past that never even really existed. So I think we're always going to see that. But I want to hear what Blizzard folks might think about that, or other people. I mean, here,
for me personally, like, when anything like that happens, or like any, like, I mean, my mom, I know that she doesn't like World of Warcraft. I don't think I ever told her I was going to go work for Blizzard. I think she'd have a heart attack if she knew I worked for the company that made that game. But me personally, I don't care. I ignore it. People are going to have opinions. Those opinions are going to be diverse, and in some way that's pretty cool. But also I just choose not to engage or share my opinion. I like to listen to other people's as well. So it's.
Yeah. Same sentiment here. I can't speak for everyone, but like, I'll say myself and a lot of people I know definitely use video games to kind of like just dive into not reality, right? Like something that's not happening in front of you, not dealing with your own stresses. And it's nice to kind of like, you know, hang out with your friends and play video games. Like it's just like a escape almost from, you know, the day-to-day stuff that's exhausting. And, you know, it should be also blissful for the people that work on those projects, right? Like you should want to feel, you should feel good to make a good product. So.
And something to talk about in that the culture war thing is that we're not just making games, we're making an interactive art. And the point of art is to reach multiple people. I mean, we touch millions of people every day with what we do. And we need to have it open for a diverse level of experiences. It doesn't work if your art is just directed at one demographic. And not only that, but we're also here to make experiences. Like one of the biggest things for me was my dad was a World War II vet. I was a teen and he was in his 70s. Diablo 2 was the last game I played with him before he died. And video games became his way to relate with me. And I will never forget that. And it is really important that we allow other people to build those experiences with those that they love. And culture has nothing to do with that because that is universal.
I told myself I wasn't going to cry on camera, but that's beautiful, Aubrey. Thank you. Well, I try to put myself back together here. We are coming up, you know, shortly here on time when we have to all log off and go back to our day jobs. But before we do that, and before I give people sort of a chance to kind of plug themselves and tell people where they can find you, I do want to. My hope is that at least one person watching this talk, if not more, will say, you know what, I really want to get out there. I really want to start organizing my workplace, whether it's a games workplace or some other industry that you're in. So my question for you all is, you know, what advice do you have for that person? What are the first steps that you take if you're like, hey, I want to make my workplace a better place for everyone who works here? Sort of where do you start with that?
I will say just having those direct conversations with the people around you. Ask them what their issue is. Don't just start talking about yours. I mean, you can relate to them as well, but even like you'd be surprised having conversations with other workers of like what their grievances are and wow, I didn't even think of this and you experienced it. So it's like nice to know that way when you do get to the broader scale of organizing, you'll know, okay, here are the things that we've already accounted for going forward, like things that people already have issues with or are experiencing. So yeah, one-on-one conversations, really important.
Something that I'll say onto that is be aware of what you can handle. This kind of stuff is really damaging to your mental and emotional health. You need to be prepared and have a check and balance system for yourself on when you can unplug and step back and when you need to step back for when it's healthy to you.
Yeah, I want to throw it to Jenny and Nora, but before I just want to say that, you know, the organizing group at Paizo has been very fluid. People have, you know, stepped in and out as they have had time and they have had the energy for it. And I think that's been really great for us because we haven't burned ourselves out. We've been able to pick each other up as we've gone on. So it's been really nice. And that's really great advice. Nora, Jenny, any other advice that you have?
Yeah, I mean, just to build off of what Jessica said, talk to each other. And I mean, people you normally disagree with is included in that. It's important to connect to each other on a human level. And even though there's value, I think, in utilizing the momentum when you have it, sometimes you just need to hear what your peers are happy and unhappy about to determine what the most significant issues are and determine whether you need to have or whether you have their buy-in on certain issues before you start taking action.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. I think also just, you know, in addition to how important talking to other people and actually listening to them is, just getting some resources for yourself. Like, I mean, for us, we chose CWA, which is Communication Workers of America. There are other unions out there, but just, you know, doing some basic education for yourself, just Googling, just going online and looking at those links and, you know, maybe seeing if you can send an email to an organizer or a representative. Like they're really helpful, and that's, you know, that's free. There's not any kind of commitment until you've actually started, you know, a card signing campaign. And even then, things like dues don't come into play until after you've negotiated a contract with your company. So I would say talk to everyone and just get educated, like arm yourself with as much information as you can get. We're lucky because, you know, as we talked to each other, we found out, oh, hey, this person's already.
Those are all really, really important advice. You've got to talk to each other. You've got to listen. Jenny, I don't remember if it was you or another one of our organizers who said earlier, the quote that stuck with me is, the hardest part of starting this is just turning to the person next to you and just talking a little bit of treason with them and then just saying, hey, you know, how are you feeling? What's going on? You don't have to start with, let's start a walkout yeah. campaign. Let's start a petition. It's just, how you feeling, man? How's it going?
Yeah. I don't think that was me that said that, but it is really hard because, you know, as one of the people who was trying to, you know, get people in the right place to make plans, I wasn't the only one, but it was really hard because there are some people at my job that I don't know at all. Even though, I mean, I can't imagine for like, you know, Nora, Jessica, and Aubrey at a big company, that would be even more so. But even at a small company like Paizo, or I guess medium company, whatever, there's people that I've never been in the office. I've never met some of these people. I couldn't pick some of them out of a lineup. And, you know, trying to find a way to say, hey, can you talk for a minute? Like on disc, like what's your Discord? Or like they're finding their Twitter. Hey, do you have like 5 minutes? You want to get coffee or do you want to like get on a Zoom call because of the, you know, the pandemic? So yeah, it's hard, but you can do it. It's, you know, it's possible.
Yeah. I say hello back to the game, to the game makers of Finland. Hello. Love to see other game workers in chat. Yeah, and I mean, definitely, you know, if you're in the games industry in particular, get in touch. I know Game Workers Australia just announced a relaunch but they've got a website. So, you know, figure out who else is in your area as well if you're at the point where you're starting to look for resources and really sort of make a movement larger. So yeah, we are down to our last few minutes. So I want to say thank you all, you know, so much for taking the time to join us all here for this event, taking the time out of your busy days at our various game companies to talk about these efforts, give some people some education. Thanks also to, Austin and Jamie for inviting us to this event as well. Before we sign off, I just want to give you all a chance to shout out to people where they can find you on the internet. I know we've given our various organizing Twitter accounts, but if there's any other things that you want to shout out anywhere else that people can find you.
I will shout out my personal Twitter. I'm at BlizzJess. I talk a lot about, you know, the current climate, Activision Blizzard, and continue the heat on Twitter if y'all want to follow me there, other than the Better APK account. But yeah, thanks.
I feel
sorry.
You're good. We were both fighting with our mics at the same time. It was amazing. I watched it both. I'm like, is she? No. Okay. You can find my personal account at CatOnCoals at Twitter. I also post a lot of activism, but I am also big tabletop nerd. You'll see everything from art to war gaming. So feel free to come by.
Hey, have you heard of a little game called Pathfinder 2nd Edition? It's great.
Yeah, I know. I came in with one of my characters. Thanks.
I guess I remember that Zoom meeting. That was amazing. So you can find me on Twitter. My personal Twitter is space princess_J, just the letter J. Also check out at Paizo Workers, as I mentioned earlier, for our official union account. My personal account, I do talk a lot about like activism and gaming and unionization. There's also just personal posting, and I'm also a big tabletop nerd, especially since I work for a company that makes it. And so that's at least work adjacent, but I do ramble on about Pathfinder and Starfinder quite a bit. So feel free to come say hi there if you'd like.
And my Twitter account is just Nora Valletta. I don't really post. In fact, I barely know how to use Twitter. I think I actually once tweeted somebody's name thinking I was typing into the search bar.
Yes, it's classic.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you all. Thank you all so much for your time. I really appreciate it. I will throw it back to Austin to close us out here today.
All right. Thank you very much, Alex, Aubrey, Nora, Jenny, and Jessica. It was a fantastic discussion. Really, really good and insightful. I just wanted to say thank you for everyone for coming. It's been a fantastic event, and I've really enjoyed this as like a celebration of over a year's worth of work that we've done to build this website, come up with the idea, and kind of make it a reality. So this is going to be a living archive project, so please add to it. I'm sure that there's stuff that we missed, so would love to add it more. You can find me on Austin Kelmore on Twitter. And also, we just launched a Game Worker Solidarity Twitter account, which is GW Solidarity, all one word, if you want to follow that and retweet it. We'll be kind of giving updates to all of the events that kind of happen in the games industry whenever we add something new to the archive. Jamie or Natalia, would you like to plug your info as well?
We have a collective action in tech Twitter @tech_actions, and our website is data.collectiveaction.tech. So check us out there.
Yeah, thanks everyone so much. Just very quickly, I'm Jamie_Woodcock on Twitter. And as Austin says, please do follow the new Game Worker Solidarity Twitter account and keep in touch with us. Thanks so much, everyone.
All right.